Before we get underway, and we're going to be starting with Article 2, as we had agreed last night, I just want to go over one or two points regarding, you know, rules within the hall. It was violated a little bit last night, and we're not going to, we would appreciate it if it would not be violated this evening. Anyone who does want to speak should rise, come to a microphone, and be recognized by the moderator. When recognized, you'll state your name and address. And if you shout out from the hall somewhere other than at a mic and without being recognized, we will ask you to sit down. We will not consider what you're trying to say at that point. And again, speakers will have 2 minutes to speak unless we allow an extension of time. A speaker may have a second opportunity to speak only when all others have had an opportunity to enter the discussion. So with that, let's get underway, and I'd like to call upon the chair of the Appropriations Committee to move Article 2.
Thank you. Thank you. Article 2, school building project. We move the article as written in the warrant articles and motions document.
Thank you. Now I'd like to call upon John Graziano to address the article for the benefit of the town meeting.
Thank you, help if I turn it on. There we go. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. My name is John Graziano. I am a member of the school committee as well as the elementary school building committee. I'm joined up here today by Mike Shepherd, who is a member of the elementary school building committee, to talk about warrant article number 2, which is for the expansion of the ongoing project for the new elementary school on Hayden Row. First of all, I just want to thank this body at town meeting for the support that we have had throughout this project. We're really excited about the progress on the new elementary school. We had a very successful groundbreaking, and anybody who drives by the site on Hayden Row can see that there's a tremendous amount of work going on, and we're excited to remain on track to open that school in September of 2018. Which probably begs the question for a lot of people, why are we here talking about an expansion to a school that we're in the process of building? So I want to provide a little context for town meeting today. Everybody awake now? Okay. My mic's down? Okay. We're back. Hopefully that won't happen again. So if we could hop to the next slide. Every year the school committee receives a set of enrollment projections based on data that is about what's going on in the town in terms of real estate transactions, children currently in the schools, births in town. It follows every November after we certify our enrollment for the current year. We have had, since we started on this project with the new elementary school, we've been seeing projections that projected fairly flat enrollment for Hopkinton students across the next decade or so. We received these updated enrollment projections. So as you can see behind me, we had for 2014, when we were originally discussing this project with the Mass School Building Authority, the projections for the next 10 years showed a decline in the number of students that we would have within the Hopkinton schools over that period. The following year, 2015, validated those numbers again. We all know here that we've been experiencing a tremendous amount of growth within our town. 2016's enrollment projections that we received just this past November showed something very different. They showed a significant increase in the number of students that we'd be seeing over the next 10 years. And more importantly, they showed that as a sustained number over that period of time. So we're not seeing a spike that's going to level off. We're seeing sustained growth within our town, within the enrollments for our students in the Hopkinton schools. So as a school committee, this was obviously important data for us to take a look at. And we began to look at its impacts across all of the buildings and grade levels. In particular, the new elementary school that we're building on Hayden Row for our pre-K through 1 students. We noted that these projections, specifically in K-1, are were going to put us in a position to have class sizes much larger than we would have wanted for the kindergarten and first grade age group when the school opened in 2018. We were very fortunate that this came up in November, because as you know, we're in the process right now of building the building, and so it allows us to react very quickly and be able to quickly accommodate this growth without disrupting the project. So I'm going to introduce Mike Shepherd, who's going to talk a little bit about where we are on the project right now, as well as how this will impact the construction.
Thank you, folks. Good evening, and thank you for coming out in this kind of yucky night. Mike Shepherd, I'm on the building committee. I'm the vice chair of the building committee. All this came about, as you know, we had the groundbreaking back in October, and they've been working out there since then. Most of this information came out really recently, as John said, back in November. And in December, the school committee digested it, and here we are in January. Essentially, we're looking to add four more classrooms. The school committee, very carefully, with the principal and the superintendent and the MSBA, they determined this is the kind of class size we want ideally for this age group. And as I understand it, the younger the kids are, the smaller the class size is most effective. So the additional classrooms will give us the opportunity to keep that class size down, even though we're having this growth. About the school and where we are now. As you know, all know, you funded the money along with the MSBA to build the school. We had a whole bunch of rounds of estimating, and we came up with a number which you folks approved. Primarily because we had a very favorable bid climate. We had a lot of people bid on the job. It's a nice, clean job. There's no remodeling. There's no additions. It's a clean site. The bids came in much, much better than we expected, to the tune of $2 million less than what we anticipated. So those of us on the building committee say, great. All the work we did when we did the value engineering, all the work that Compass did, all the work that our contractor did, all the work that our architect did paid off. At the end of this school project, we'll have $2 million to kick back to you folks and us, the taxpayers. And then this came about. So we pretty quickly realized that there may be a problem. And if I may, up on the slide, this is my first red dot experience, so I'm gonna be kind of shaky. EMC Park is up here. Hayden Row Street is down here. These are the parking lots. This is the bus turnaround, the bus loop. The German cafeteria up here. Now, a lot of the site work has already been done. All the sewer lines are in. All the water lines are in. Most of the drainage is in. There's big drainage components underneath these two parking lots. They're all already installed. That's what they've been doing for the last 3 months. And also, the foundation guys have been out, and they started up in this corner, and they worked around, and they did this part of the building, and they came over to here, and it wasn't planned, but this is where we were right about here when we found out that the school may have to be bigger. We told you at town meeting, somebody asked, can we expand this thing? And we said, yes, we could. And the architect provided us with drawings and said, this is the ideal place to expand if you ever need to, up to 8 classrooms. The planning board, who's been very helpful through this whole process, also asked the same question. Do you have a place you can expand this? And we said, yes, we do. So that's the area. It was just fortunate and good timing that the foundation guys were right about there when all this came about. So they didn't have to go home. They're still there. They're doing work on the interior of the foundation. And ideally, if this passes, the foundation guys will be able to keep working and close the loop on that section. The steel is due to arrive in March, and they'll start erecting the steel. Most of the masonry work and the skin of the building will be over the summer. So we're right on schedule. So by doing this addition, it doesn't add any extra time. By doing it now, we're not, you know, putting an addition on a school that already exists and the interruption to the kids and the classrooms and the parking and the traffic and all that stuff. So it just is an ideal time. The cost, the estimated cost for the addition, the four classrooms, including all the site work that goes around the school, the additional water retention areas, additional parking, the additional infrastructure is $3.5 million. So you say, oh, Mike, you just told me I was going to get $2 million back. Well, that's actually why we're asking for $1.5 million for this project. We're counting on the two that we have in there. All of you have done additions on your house, I suspect, or know somebody that has. The worst part of the addition is the beginning, where they dig the hole because they don't know what's there. They don't know if it's a swamp. They don't know if it's a ledge. This site, what we all anticipated was going to be tougher than it is, it's been great. The water has been low. There's been no ledge. So we'll be able to work right along. We can get some savings there. So by doing this now and voting this tonight, we still have to go to the planning board. We still have to go to conservation. But these two outfits have been great and very cooperative with us, so we can keep the school on target and move in here, as John said, in September of 2018. So it's four additional classrooms. There's another slide that the shows the floor plan.
No, that's the other.
Well, the architect was very creative. This is that end of the building that I'm talking about. This is the kindergarten and first grade. One of them's on the first floor. One of them's on the first floor, one of them's on the second floor. So what they've done is they've made this, the building is made in modules. So this little piece right here that doesn't exist now, they're going to take this piece, slide it over 28 feet in this direction, and insert this. At the end of the day, by next spring, next fall, when the skin goes on the building, the windows go in, nobody's going to tell this is where the school ended, this is where the addition started. That's the other beauty of it. You don't have a building that opens brand new that looks like, you know, it was cobbled together. It's all part of the plan. So that's about it in a nutshell. And again, you know, John, I, the building committee, the school committee, all ask for your support. You've been great, and you know, I wouldn't suspect anything else. It's a great town to be from. Thank you, folks. We can take care of any questions.
But before we ask for questions, I'd like to confirm that Appropriations has approved this request.
Yes, the Appropriation Committee does recommend this article. I just want to call out a couple of points that when we were looking at the financial aspect of this, that if we delayed and waited a couple of years, we were not going to get any additional MSBA funding unless we started this whole process over again, and the amount we would may get from them would not even cover the costs of going through this process again. By doing it now, we have the efficiency that we're already in the process, everything's there, they're ready to pour the concrete. So you're just going to have eventual cost savings there. Also, the fact that this funding or the borrowing will fall within the levy limit, meaning by approving tonight, we're not going to have a ballot in a couple of weeks or months. So by approving it today, they can essentially start the process tomorrow to go through with it. So given that, we recommend this article.
And is the representative or chair of the Capital Improvements Committee here?
Yes. Capital Improvements also recommends approving this article.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are there questions for the committees?
Mr. Moderator, Mary Arnott, 51 Teresa Road. I was just curious about the projections with all of the additional students coming in that's being projected. Do you assume that all of those students will enter the school, the elementary, the public schools, or do you take into account that some may attend charter schools, private schools, homeschooling? If you could address that for me, please.
Sure, that's a great question. The enrollment projections do take into account that not all residents of school age will be attending the public schools, and they base that on historical projections of how many students have attended other schools, including private schools, vocational schools, etc.
So if I may, Mr. Moderator, follow up?
Yes.
So the numbers that were shown on the screen, does that take into account that that's not all the students entering the town?
Yes, that would be, that's projected enrollments for the Hopkinton Public School System. So
but
that's
you don't
not
have
all,
it.
That's not all, that not necessarily all students.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Mr. Moderator, again, you don't have any idea though of how what percent of the total students that represents or not? Rough guess?
I'm looking over where there might be, and I'm going to go with no.
Mr. Moderator, this is a report that we do annually, and I don't have the exact numbers with me tonight.
Please but identify yourself.
Oh, Kathy McLeod, Superintendent.
Thank you.
But they're minimal. I'd say at the K-1 level, less than 10.
Less than 10 people or less than 10%?
Students.
10 students.
Who would not be attending our schools.
On my right.
Chris Rommel, 5 Cold Spring Brook. Question on the projected enrollments. Just wondering, based on the fact that the last projections were pretty far off the current ones, how confident are you that these would, in fact, align with the growth in the town, mm-hmm. considering the total impact of Legacy Farm, some of the other, I guess, developments being explored, such as that off of Chamberlain? Just what, given that it seems like it's an ideal time to expand, is the 4-classroom option the best fit now?
So we did look at that, and you're right. Typically, we have some divergence from the actual enrollments to what NESDEC has projected, and that's obviously difficult for us to predict year to year, especially in the K-1 grades. Those tend to be the most volatile grades. But what we did in identifying that we wanted to expand 4 additional classrooms was that we were able to then drive down the average class size enough, and by adding the 2 additional classrooms per grade level, it gave us some cushion so that if you had, let's say, an influx of 26 students within that we weren't expecting within that grade level above projections, it's only 1 more student per class. So it might put us at 19 in kindergarten instead of 18, which is still within the optimal number. So we felt like by going to a higher number of classrooms, adding additional 4 on top of this, the numbers just didn't support it. And what we really didn't want to be in is a position where we had an underutilized school building. So we felt like this gave us enough flexibility if those projections, because it tends to be in the neighborhood of 20 or so low the past few years, and this will allow us to accommodate that.
Okay, thank you.
On my left.
Bob Levinson, 13 Smith Road. Similar question about the projections. I'd like to know what changed from the previous projections and what gives you confidence now that you had before that you don't have anymore and the new numbers.
So what changed is a great question. I think some of us would all like to know that. I think these enrollment projections that show this growth seem to tie more realistically to what we're seeing in the schools year to year. So as the last questioner pointed out, especially in the K-1 grades, we're getting these projections and then it's consistently 20 higher every year. So this lines up more with what those numbers are that are coming in, and that's what gives us the confidence that they're starting to take into account the drivers. We have a lot of unique demographic things happening in Hopkinton. We had a lengthy presentation from the consultant from NESDEC who does these projections for us. And he identified in this projection some statistical anomalies that he had not had in previous projections that make us feel like these are more on point. And again, by bringing those up in the lower levels, it's more consistent with what we've been seeing year to year. So that's what gives us that confidence.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you for your work with all this.
Appreciate sure. It.
Sandy Altamira, Elm Street. I have a comment and a question. The first comment is, we all hate to spend more money. This is going to be a very expensive deal, but to build a brand new school and then have trailers parked next to it is ridiculous. So if we're going to build, we have to build it now. My question is, if you're asking for $1.5 million, why isn't that a ballot question?
Typically, it would be a ballot question, but because of the amount and the ability to fall within the levy limit that we can put that borrowing, in this particular case, there is a need for to make this, you know, to do this quicker and get started. Otherwise, we'd have to wait several months, and this almost could be a no-go just because it would delay the opening of the school another year, and it wouldn't be worth it. So this is one way of being able to move it right along.
On my right, Ken.
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street. First of all, I'd like to compliment the school department on doing such a great job that people are coming to town, and that's part of the major reason, I believe, that we're selling houses in Hopkinton, and also our housing values continue to climb. I have a couple of questions. The first is, on the pre-K classrooms, you're not adding anywhere there. Is there also additional enrollment expected in pre-K?
We don't have the same expected enrollment growth in pre-K. Some people may be aware of, the pre-K program isn't a townwide pre-K program. So in many ways, there are some children who are required to go through that pre-kindergarten program, but then we exercise a large amount of control over the maximum amount of students that we want to allow in the program. So while we'd love to bring as many kids in as we possibly can, we're both not seeing the growth in enrollment, but also we don't feel the need because there is some sort of option on the part of the school department. Additionally, if I think back to the first question that was asked about the percentage of students that go to Hopkinton Public Schools versus private schools, regardless of our offering, that is a lot higher in pre-K. The vast majority of students in pre-K end up going to private pre-kindergarten programs anyway.
Mr. Moderator, next question I have is, what's like the number of classrooms in this building versus Center School? And my basis of this question is, are we going to now have a bunch more teachers, at least four or maybe even more, that are going to kind of hit in the operating budget once we have a place to lower the class size?
So we are we're definitely increasing the number of sections as we shift from Center School to this school. Actually, as we were going through our budget process this past year, I noted, as tough as this is to believe, to Mrs. DeBow when she was making the presentation, that the next budget presentation she would be making to us would actually be for the new building. So we are, and this is absolutely information I should have off the top of my head, but is it 11 and 10 that we are? So we have 21 total classrooms in the Center School right now. So this would be 26 classrooms. So it would potentially necessitate staffing increases, but we have to look at what that actually looks like come budget time. The reality is, you know, when you lower the class sizes, there's also, you know, you can allocate your staff differently.
Okay. And last couple comments. First of all, I applaud the fact that you're keeping it within the levy limit. I think that's a good thing. We've had a lot of growth in town revenue through a lot of this new growth, and the fact that we're spending it on something that we would normally bond, I think is a very good point for the town. It'll just require us to be a little more stingy, I guess, on other operating things that we normally do. From a planning board standpoint, I met with the principal planner, with members of the staff, and we expressed that the only things that we're really concerned about is parking, and then the amount of extra impervious surface has an impact on the stormwaters. And I can only say I'm only one member of that committee, but we expect a fairly quick approval once you get through the engineers talking about both of those subjects. Thank you.
Thank you. On my right?
Darlene Hayes, 1/3 Road. I'd like to move the question.
Yeah. Well, is there anyone who would like to speak to, virtually all of this has been in favor. I'd like to give an opportunity if there is someone opposed before we call the question. Is there anyone who would like to speak who is opposed? No. On my right.
Sorry, Mr. Moderator, I wish I didn't have to get up and talk. But what I see going on here is we are trying to add a little bitty stone to a large project. And 5 years from now, they'll need every one of those classrooms and probably four more. And so I don't understand if we're going to take a building that is brand new, which is always easier to change in the construction phase, why we aren't going for the 8 classrooms and another 28 feet. I've heard people say if we have to do this in the future, and we probably will because the town is not going to stop growing. That's a fact of life. And it will cost us probably twice as much to put another 4 classrooms on that building. We need efficiency in this town. That's one thing I don't feel we do well enough yet. And efficiency means we put what we have available land, what we have available money, and that's going to be a little bit of a problem. But to just add those extra 4 rooms right now to the ones you're already going to move the modular end of the building out, move it another 28 feet, and put 8 classrooms in there. Block them off if you're not going to use them right away, but I guarantee the day that that is finished and all 8 of those classrooms are in there, they'll find a use for them. And there's no sense in not building out the maximum amount of school that we can put on a lot like that, where we probably will have a real problem trying to do anything else, and we'll end up with another building sooner. So, you know, when this very building was built, I went to school here from the 6th grade. And when they originally designed it, the building was too big. They had 5th and 6th grade, then they had the junior high wing, and then they had the high school. And it served us extremely well because the people who designed and built this knew that the town was going to grow, and it did.
I'd like to give the committee an opportunity to respond to what you're saying. So, Mike, would you address this?
Yes, sir. Thank you. It's a very good question. It's a comment we've heard before. Why don't you do all 8 now instead of the 4? It's going to cost us a little more. Just get it over with. Well, part of it is you, the folks that are paying the taxes, and me, entrust us with being somewhat fiscally responsible. And if we can't fill the other 4 classrooms, the fact that we can't fill them for another 10 years doesn't make any sense at this juncture. What you can fully expect going down the road is this little bubble at the center school is going to affect Elmwood School. It's going to affect Hopkins School. It's going to affect the high school. People like me will be back before people like you asking for more money for them, before we need it for this. So we just want to be fiscally responsible. You're right. It would be cheaper to do it now, but, you know, I can't ask people to pay for something we can't use. We just can't justify it. I'm sorry.
Okay. On my left.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Amy Groves, 2 College Street. Again, I call the question, which has already been called. I call the question.
Is there a second? All those in favor of limiting debate at this point, say aye. All opposed?
No.
It needs to be 2/3, so I think we're going to get some exercise. Muriel, do we have our counters? Okay, if you're in favor of limiting debate, please rise and hold your orange card.
What are we standing up for?
Stage can sit.
Center front, 10.
Center back, 24.
Yes. Yeah.
left 24. Right 41.
Okay. All those opposed to limiting debate, please rise and hold your card.
Left 11.
Center rear 5.
Mr. Moderator, center front is actually 12.
Okay. And on the right?
Right is 8.
8 on the right. 17, 28, 41. Okay. We have voted to limit debate. So now we're going to vote on the article itself. So a vote in favor authorizes the school building committee to proceed with this project as they have described it. Again, this is a two-thirds vote. All those in favor of Article 2 as presented, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And it's unanimous, and so voted.
Thank you very much, folks.
Thank you.
Now we go to the fireworks. Okay. If you remember from last evening, we agreed to lay on the table two items relating to charter. So now we're back to Article 1 and the charter review itself. And those two items were as follows. There was a proposal to change the charter to call for an elected town treasurer and or collector. And there was also a proposal to impose a residency requirement on the town manager. And so those are the two items that we're going to bring off the table. And with that, hope to conclude our discussion on the charter review so that we can take a vote on Article 1 on the proposed charter as amended this evening. So with that, let's start with the topic of an elected versus an appointed town treasurer. Is there at this point a motion that the maker wants to advance with respect to an elected versus appointed town treasurer?
Frank Durso, 173 Saddle Hill Road. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Have worked with the town councils on this and getting further information from our town employees and our appropriations committee person, Pam Wexlax, was very helpful. I've kind of reconsidered some of what I was presenting yesterday. I do have a new updated motion from town council that I believe is worthy of discussion, but I don't know if this is the time for the discussion for this. I have a replacement amendment that I would like to offer instead, but I'm not sure of the procedure for that. So where there has been a seconded amendment presented, we haven't had discussion on it, and I'm not sure of the procedure to replace that amendment, let alone update it.
Well, what I want to ask is whether you do, again, we agreed to defer discussion until we had a fully vetted motion or amendment to be proposed as it related to elected versus appointed town treasurer tax collector.
Well, we do have a vetted amendment that's been updated and fits the requirements for the Attorney General's submission.
But specific to town treasurer tax collector?
Specific to that position, and we can't discuss it.
If you have that, I'd like it to be presented on the screen so the town meeting members can see what what it entails. Has it been provided to the?
I believe that is it with section 4.2. There is a version of that that lists the changes that must be made to other sections for the wording. But basically, it starts with the section 4.2 town treasurer, term of office, powers and duties.
All right, if you would, in 300 words or less, specifically what's being proposed and what's the rationale for the proposal.
Okay. The original idea was to restore an elected town treasurer to town hall to provide oversight for town finances. Since then, I've learned that the Appropriations Committee provides oversight for finances and are actually a year-round committee, and they're a go-to committee for problems and questions. The rationale for presenting having an elected town treasurer was that so that people can have a voice in town hall. Now, my original motion from yesterday, and I believe it's as it is today, does not have the treasurer take on the daily role of the activities. It has oversight of the activities. But now I understand that our current town treasurer / collector, two positions and one person, does that role and performs it. I have no problem with how the current employees perform their work, but I would prefer to have some sort of oversight, elected oversight, voice of the people in town hall. I don't know what else to really say about it. I could read what we have here for powers and duties that are specific to this motion. And if this change were to be approved, it would be effective for 2018 elections. But I do have an alternative amendment I'd like to present.
Well, we need to confine our discussion to this amendment. The amendment last night, consider that not effective. This is the amendment that you're putting forward as it relates to the revision that you would like to see to the charter, which would call for an elected treasurer.
Right. As reviewed by town council and in the right format.
Is there a second to this motion?
Second.
Okay, it's been seconded. Is there discussion related to this? Let me start with the charter review.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. If you could put up the DOR slide.
So this is taken from a letter to the Board of Selectmen in the town of Upton April of 2014, related to the proposal to take their treasurer from an elected position to a appointed position. And I just want to point out this one particular paragraph. The letter is in a handout outside, but the DLS technical assistance section has completed almost 550 projects over a span of 30 years, advising cities and towns on matters of financial management and government structure. From this experience, we have recognized and advocate the principle that in government, policymakers should be elected and operational positions where particular qualifications and skill sets are required should be appointed. I would like to note, Mr. Durso did bring this up in the September public forum, that he was in favor of keeping the town clerk elected and even considering going back to an elected town treasurer. He additionally asked consideration for additional members put onto the Board of Selectmen and the school committee. Our committee reviewed and considered all comments from that forum and at that time determined not to proceed further with an elected treasurer. There was no further communication on this topic after the public forum until last night. So we basically stand with keeping the treasurer appointed at this point.
Thank you. On my right. Still not.
It's. Are we there?
Yes.
Connie Wright, 25 Amherst Road. I feel strongly that this needs to be an appointed position. There are a number of qualifications for this position. Last night I had a nice chuckle because I'm like to affectionately say I'm a recovering CPA. And through you, the moderator, I would like the town to consider how many tonight know government accounting regulations in this hall. How many of you tonight know how to do a cash flow, burn, accrual accounting, how to do a true government financial statement? And I can tell you that the number of qualified individuals in this town are probably less than 10. And I'm not too certain many of them, and it's probably less than 5, would want to run for this position. So to have the thought that we could have somebody run who is not qualified is, we've grown. This really requires a resume, years of experience, and levels of qualification. So I respectfully suggest that at tonight's special town meeting, we require this to be an appointed position, which allows us to hire a qualified and vetted individual. Thank you.
Thank you. On my left.
Mike Manning, 32 Briarcliff Drive. I also am, I'd like to see this remain as an appointed position. I've been on the Appropriations Committee for about 5.5 years, 6 years now. And before I was on Appropriations, I pay my bills, my tax bills, and it says, send your taxes to collector of taxes. And I suppose that's the face of the town when you send your tax bills in. But now that I've been on Appropriations Committee for several years, I've actually had to work with the treasurer, and they do a little bit more now. Now they're taking care of all our borrowing. They're figuring out what the bonds are, short term, long term. Are the town's cash investments, and some of the numbers I just got from our finance director, Chris Sandini. The debt issued right now is $53 million. The authorized debt, but not yet issued, is $72 million. And total cash investments, other things coming in, is $42 million. So this is the person managing all these funds, deciding where to invest, what terms, what rates, and they're negotiating. And if you want this to be an elected position, maybe you'll have 2 people running for the spot, 3 people, and maybe some have municipal finance experience. If it's an appointed position, you can at least do a search for resumes, maybe get dozens or 20 people to vet it from, possibly out of town. You're looking for the best person to deal with the town's money and bonds. So in my view, I really think if I wouldn't be comfortable knowing that someone who's not competent or qualified gets this position could really bankrupt the town. Not that it would happen, but you know, you really want the best person for this position. I think appointed is the way to go.
Thank you. On my right?
Yeah, Ken Dietz, 44 Alexander Road. I have a question about this. Originally, it was stated that there was a treasurer position and a collector position, and I presume that's what's meant here. If we make the town treasurer the elected position, then it would certainly fit the policymaker part component of that state statement. And the tax collector would be the one that would provide the resume and have the qualifications for the duties of the job, I would have thought. Now, is that correct?
Who can address that? Town manager?
Good evening, town meeting. Yes. Not yet.
There you go.
Okay, good evening, town meeting, and thank you everybody for coming out on such a tough night. The answer to your question is no.
Well, no what? I mean, does that mean there's one position that it's a dual treasurer collector, or that there are two positions, one being a treasurer and one being a collector?
I understood your question to suggest that the treasurer will be the policymaker.
Yes.
And that the collector will be the operational position.
Yes.
And I'm responding that the answer is no. Here's why. I have not seen the job description for a treasurer that makes that position defined as a policymaker. We already have boards in town that assist in policymaking. The Board of Selectmen is the chief elected board in town. The Appropriations Committee, the committee that we work with the staff to develop the financial policies for the town. And we have a process for the budget process in town that we follow. Additionally, I think as has been explained, we already have boards and committees in town that define the town's investment policy as well as the cash policies in broad terms. Operationally, the work is performed by the treasurer under the guidance of the finance director. That's why my answer is no.
Can I follow up on that?
Quickly, yes.
Well, the Appropriations Committee is not elected. I don't know how it's determined. It's appointed, I guess. Something I've never understood quietly. But they advise. They don't do anything more than just simply advise. Now, so the only real policymaker, as far as I can see, are the selectmen, which is okay. But they would seem to have that role. And I don't know who the finance director is. That's an appointed position, I would assume.
Yes, it is. Yeah. But basically, you're rising in favor of the proposal to go elected.
Exactly.
Is that what you're saying? Okay.
For that component that does not require a detailed skill set, as suggested here by the government statement. In other words, that there is a person who has the skill set to do the job, but there's also one that can oversee the job. And that's the position I'm talking about as treasurer.
All right, thank you. On my left.
Clifford Kistner, 86 West Main Street in Hopkinton. You know, I'm on the planning board in town, and I'm new to the statuses of the boards and how things work. And sometimes I end up making calculated decisions based upon what the people are looking for, and then based upon my own personal belief, and then I look also at the logistics of what it entails to make that decision. Last night, I was kind of swayed to look at where I came from as an elected official, and I realized that through the handouts of this particular thing, and it goes into great length, that it serves as a better proposal to have it as not an elected position, and I'm showing that I'm changing my stance on that, as long as we meet those criteria of what is set forth on the letters that were proposed this evening, that we vet the people that are coming in to fill those criteria, I believe that it's a better way for the town to handle the situation.
As an appointed?
As an appointed, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Am I right?
Leslie Albert Ficari, 57 Greenwood Road. I do not support this change. I do believe that the position should be appointed. People go to college for this for 4 years, sometimes 6 to 8 years, if they're getting additional schooling. We are a very complicated and large town now. I think I heard $72 million. People are making decisions about our borrowing, et cetera. There are people who are very trained to do this, and I think that we should not limit ourselves in the pool of candidates that we are looking at for opportunities like that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Moderator, Mary Arnott, 51 Teresa Road. I stand in support of this amendment. Given the growth of our town, the size of our budgets, the amount of money we're investing, our debt, and all of the people who are involved at handling all of this, there are appointed boards, appointed positions. I believe an elected town treasurer would be a good addition to have checks and balances, to make sure as all of this is being handled that we have someone else looking at it and advising everyone involved with our financials. So I stand in support of this amendment.
Thank you.
Mike Heumann of 24 Chestnut. My question is, if we make this an elected position, can we not pre-qualify people by putting a set of conditions that they have to meet before they could pull a ballot?
No.
No. Okay, but it's... Okay, thank you.
No. Is there any further discussion with respect to this?
Todd Sestari, 19 Elizabeth Road. I was just wondering, I'm not clear, is this elected position going to be a paid position? And if so, I guess I'm wondering what's currently one position handling all these duties, are there going to be additional duties or are we going to end up paying two people to do the same amount of work?
I can ask the maker, or has he covered it in the language? No, but, okay. I'd like to ask the maker to come up and address those questions. And whether it's in fact covered. So I think there are a couple of questions.
Mm-hmm.
Is the compensation something which is covered within the motion or the amendment that you've provided? And is there a clear definition of whether we're talking about, two positions or one position?
I can answer that. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Through you, to the Mr. Sestari. I believe that the compensation will be set the same way as the town treasurer. I'm sorry, the town clerk. And the other question you asked is
that so provided in the language that you've furnished us?
I'll defer that to the town council.
So under the general laws, all salaries of all elected officials have to be voted every year by town meeting. We're all familiar that we vote every year for the salary of the town clerk. If this were to, this amendment were to be accepted and the charter were to be adopted in May, this would become a second position that the town meeting would vote on every year at the annual town meeting.
Thank you. And through the moderator, the other question is the town collector is currently a joint position with town treasurer. It's appointed. The motion as it stands has a section where it separates the two positions effective, May 2018. So there would be two positions, as there have been previously in the past. They were joined together 10, 12, 15 years ago. Well, it's already 2017.
So this would require two people in place of what is now one?
Yes.
John Catino, 1 David Joseph Road.
First, I'd just like to make a clarification that the town council helping pen this by no means, I believe, is endorsing this amendment. I just wanted to first make that because I didn't want it seems to be coming off that the that town council was.
Town council has been involved to be sure that anything that is presented in front of us complies with his understanding of the law and ties in, is an integral part of the proposed charter as it has been currently drafted.
And my other comment is that after decades, the town in its great wisdom decided to come up with a town charter and then said every 10 years we're going to tweak it to make it to see if we can make things better. And then a large committee spent over a year doing these tweaks and doing the pros and cons, just like when we were talking about an appointed versus an elected position for the town clerk. We saw pros and cons up there. What worries me is that when we do changes on the fly like this, right now we're asking questions, well, is it going to be paid? Is it two positions, one position? Then there may be other areas in the charter that aren't changed correctly, and we may not be making something better. It may sound good, it may feel good, there may be some areas that make people feel better, but I think that this change is just too quick and needs to be vetted more, so I am against this.
Thank you. On my left.
Hi, Darlene Hayes, 1/3 Road. It kills me. As much as I want as much citizens' input and citizens to have elected positions, this one just can't be. We're talking nearly $100 million, but we need something that is an oversight process for whether it's the Appropriations Committee, an ombudsman, or something that is an oversight for our town money. This position is not one that should be elected. We're at that point, being somewhat of a townie, it's just we've grown to a point that this can't be. It's just too much money, too much oversight. And it kills me that, you know, I want to take this away from, you know, as an elected, but it needs to stay the way it is. Thanks.
Thank you. On my right.
I make a move to pull the motion off the table. All questions off the table. Excuse me.
Are you asking to end debate?
End debate, yes.
Is there a second? Okay, all those in favor of ending discussion on this proposed amendment to the proposed charter, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Okay, clearly 2/3. So now we will vote on the proposed amendment, which is to amend the proposed charter to incorporate an elected town treasurer. All those in favor of the amendment as presented, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
Okay, and it's defeated. Okay, the other element of the that we had laid on the table last evening was a proposal to incorporate a residency requirement with respect to the town manager. Is there a formal amendment that has been provided with respect to this proposal?
There is, Mr. Moderator. Hi, Jim Cirillo, 35 Wood Street. There is a motion, which I will read. Ready for the motion?
Please go ahead.
That section 3-2A2 of the charter as proposed for the Charter Review Committee pursuant to warrant Article 1 be amended to provide a residency requirement for the town manager by inserting at the end of the second sentence thereof the following, semicolon, provided, however, that no person shall be eligible to hold the position of town manager who is not a resident of the town of Hopkinton except during the first 6 months following the town manager's initial appointment or in the case of a town manager serving on July 1, 2017, reappointment. That's the motion that was written up by town council, and I agree that that's fine.
Right. Is there a second? Would you like to present a rationale for the
sure.
amendment?
Yes, please, briefly. And I just want to ask Town Council something about the way this is worded. At the should there be in front of the word reappointment at the end to make it clear, should the word following be there? That is, there are two conditions. One is following the town manager's initial appointment. The second condition is following reappointment of the town manager serving on July 1. You know what I'm saying? So inserting the word following might make it, made it clear to me.
I don't think it's necessary.
Okay, great. Then we won't do it. I'm fine with this.
All right.
So, Mr. Moderator, I propose this charter revision because, as I said last night, I think the town is large enough. I think the town is so large in terms of our budget and our school population and our citizens that it's time to consider having town manager have a residency requirement. On some of the towns that were on the list from CRC, the model communities, I forget what they were called, Northborough, Andover, Bellingham, and Ipswich have town have residency requirements. So given the size of the town now, I think it is, at the very least, worth the discussion of whether the town manager should have residency requirement and be, you know, live in the town, have residence in the town, and experience the same things that we all experience, and you know, because the town manager is essentially running the entire town. Experience the schools, experience the roads, experience the infrastructure, and maybe most importantly, experience the tax rate. So that's it. Thank you.
I'd like to ask Charter Review. Pam, would you comment on this?
Certainly. Would you put up the town manager residency requirement slide, please? The committee only heard of this through a comment made to myself at the Conservation Commission meeting by Mr. Cirillo on January 23rd of this month. I brought it forward to our meeting last Wednesday, but by that point, all of our deliberations had been completed, and the proposed charter was already finalized at our January 3rd meeting. Other than the summary benchmark communities researched on this topic, I'm going to have to suggest that our committee members stand up and speak individually as residents, as we have not taken a position on this because we did not consider it and did not know about it.
Okay, it's open for questions, discussion from any of the voters. On my left.
Bob Levinson, 13 Smith Road. Just let me begin by adding my voice to the chorus from last night to thank every member of the review committee for your tremendous amount of work, with the ultimate reward of having many of us pick apart what you did. So thank you very much. I'd like to speak against this. While I feel it might be emotionally satisfying in the short term to have a residency requirement for town manager, I believe it's not in the long-term interest of the town. I think, in matter of fact, as the town grows, the skills and knowledge and expertise that the job requires us to have a large pool to pull from, and I would imagine that the potential candidate pool within Hopkinton is extremely small, if not, in fact, non-existent. Having one of us who has to live with the pain of increased taxes will only get us so far. As the town grows, the job of town manager will become even more complex, requiring more than just a local address. By limiting to locals, we severely limit our potential pool of qualified candidates for a job that is critical to the town. I urge we choose our town manager based on competence and not residence. Thank you.
Thank you. On my right.
Brendan Tedstone, 45 Pleasant Street. I'm against this motion as well, and I'm against it for a few reasons. First of all, to speak to Mr. Cirillo's point, our current town manager doesn't set the tax rate. So I know that that was one of his points, that he wanted to have him experience the tax rate. He doesn't set it. We do, as selectmen. Secondly, this, I'll echo Mr. Levinson's sentiments as far as trying to keep us open to get the best possible candidate in this town. And if that candidate does fall in the zip code of Hopkinton, I'm all for it. If it doesn't, I think we need to choose the best person for the job and not based on their zip code. And most importantly for me is where does something like this end? If we make the town manager responsible to live in Hopkinton, what's next? Is the superintendent, fire chief, police chief? It could be a trickle-down effect where, you know, there are people that work, you know, firefighters don't live in town, police don't live in town, people that work for the schools don't live in town, but they're doing a pretty good job. And I don't like to have to require their zip code to be in Hopkinton to be part of our machine that we call the town government. So that's why I am against it.
Thank you. On my left.
Mike Manning, 32 Briarcliff Drive. I also am against this amendment. Like the others before me have been saying, it just makes the pool of applicants smaller, this requirement. And also, I feel that the town manager does not necessarily make all the policy, set all the rules. They are direct oversight of the Board of Selectmen, who are directly responsible for the decisions made or oversight of the decisions made. And I don't think the town manager has that much flexibility to do on his own. Everything is watched by the Board of Selectmen and the town. So I don't think this is warranted, this amendment.
Thank you.
Todd Sestari, 19 Elizabeth Road. I'm on the Board of Selectmen. I was also on the Charter Review Committee. First of all, I want to thank the whole Charter Review Committee. It was a long year. We had in the area of 35 or so meetings. Pam and Michelle, they're among the hardest workers that I've seen among in town volunteers. You know, certainly there are others who equal them. One person who may not be a volunteer, but certainly equals them, is our current town manager. Over the past 8 years, I've seen Mr. Camallo work tirelessly for this town. As I think about this proposed requirement, and I look at this list of towns, one conversation comes back to me when it was, we were discussing the town clerk and appointed versus elected. And one of the facts, I guess, that the Charter Review Committee put up in front of people was the number of towns that were using an appointed town clerk versus an elected town clerk. And the response we had was, Hopkinton is not any of these towns. We're our own town. And so that's how I see things. You know, we are our own town. I think that we do need to keep a pool as open as we can for qualified candidates. And I'd also like to ask everybody here, if you got a new job and you had to move to take it, would you? And then knowing that after that, if you got another new job, you had to move again, would you? Because I think that that's the position that we're that some people are attempting to put our town manager in, whether it's our current town manager or future town managers, and it just doesn't seem appropriate to me in this day and age.
Thank you. On my left.
Beth Herlihy, 23 Longwood Drive. I also stand in opposition to this. And not only did I have the privilege of serving for the past year on this Charter Review Committee, but I also was on the original Charter Commission. And we met for almost 2 years deliberating over issues like this. The biggest thing that we faced 2 years ago was the creation of the town manager position. And we discussed every aspect of it for hours and hours and hours, and this did come up. And we discussed it extensively. We looked at other towns, we looked at ourselves. We ultimately decided that it's in the best interest of the town to have the biggest pool of applicants possible. And I just want everybody to know that we really did carefully consider it as a board for 2 years. And we unanimously did not recommend it. And as everybody knows, our town charter passed overwhelmingly at the polls. And so I really don't think it's in the best interest of the town. Thank you.
Thank you. On my right.
Claire Wright, 28 Hayden Row Street. Ms. Herlihy just spoke to a few of my points. I wanted to thank the Charter Committee, and in doing that, also remind everyone the tremendous amount of work they put in. And some of these on-the-fly amendments that are coming up that are not tinkering around the edges with the Charter, they're proposing serious, large structural changes. This committee has worked tirelessly and put in so many hours and given the public multiple opportunities. They've gone through our current charter with a fine-tooth comb over every word in every sentence. And so I am very troubled with some really seriously substantive changes that are being brought up at the 11th hour without the full vetting and proper consideration for unforeseen consequences that the Charter Committee was established to oversee and hopefully prevent. As far as a residency requirement for the town manager, and bear in mind from the inception of having a town manager, it has not been a residency requirement. That's been decided that this was the most, the wisest, best suited method for our town government. But one thing that stands out to me is the significant possibility for a conflict of interest that a town manager who is a resident could face. Right now, there's been a lot of discussion just in our town about conflicts of interest with abutters or nearby residents inciting a town trail. I can only imagine the handicapped and the appearance of impropriety a town manager would face on multiple issues that would come across his or her desk on a daily basis, where that person's integrity could be questioned because they are living in town. In fact, I would suggest a requirement that the town manager not be a resident of the town. In my opinion, the town manager is employed by the town of Hopkinton. Just the way EMC is your employer or General Motors is your employer, you work for that entity to promote their interest to the best of your ability. And being a resident adds a layer of conflict that I think is a very dangerous thing for this town. These kind of amendments, when we get to the point of voting for the charter, they will be a deal breaker for me.
Thank you. Ken?
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street. I rise to oppose this requirement for the town manager. It almost sounds like you're looking for a elected town mayor as opposed to a town manager, because that's usually what happens, and we're certainly not at the point in size that we need to be that form of city government. I'd like to compliment the Charter Review Committee on this paragraph. You can read along on page 3-4, which gives the qualifications required by the Charter for the town manager. It says, the town manager shall be a professionally qualified person of proven ability, especially fitted by education, training, and previous experience to perform the duties of this office. The town manager shall be appointed solely on the basis of the candidate's executive and administrative qualifications. The town manager shall not have served as a member of the Board of Selectmen for at least 5 years prior to the town manager's appointment. The town may, by town bylaw, establish additional qualifications for the town manager as deemed necessary or appropriate. I'd like to call attention to a couple of the last two sentences in that. The one is we don't want a town manager that has been on the Board of Selectmen in reasonable time. I know there was concern when we originally adopted the charter that the Board of Selectmen would appoint one of their own to be the town manager as opposed to going on a long search and finding the best person for it. Second of all, the last paragraph or sentence in that paragraph says that the town, by town bylaw, which means us at town meeting, can establish additional qualifications if we need them, and if they're necessary or appropriate. So there is a way where this could be done at an annual town meeting if it was deemed to be required. I would not put this requirement firmly in the charter, and I urge everyone to vote no on this amendment.
Thank you. On my right?
Leslie Albert Ficari, 57 Greenwood Road. Many of the points that I wanted to make have already been said, but I will just add to something that Mr. Sesteri said, is if we did have a residency requirement, we would most likely have to pay relocation expenses for the person, and that would be a minimum of $100,000 to do that. Secondly, as Ms. Wright said, the conflict of interest issue is a big one for me. I feel that our current town manager is able to speak truth to power and really act as a consultant to the Board of Selectmen, and he is not pulled by his own interests by living in the town. Thank you.
Thank you. On my left?
Samantha Dings, 3 Wordy Circle. I noticed looking up there at the residency requirement slide that only 6 of 17 benchmark communities have any residency requirement at all. And of those, only 3 have an absolute residency requirement. Half of them say they can live in the town next door, or the selectman can actually waive it. So since I don't see many comparable communities actually having a residency requirement, we don't need one. And so I oppose this amendment.
On my right?
Dale Danahy, 25 East Main Street. I need clarification. I don't understand if town council could be asked, by having a residency requirement, why can't we still go outside the town to hire somebody, get the pool of applicants that we want, and then ask them, then they be required to live in the town after they get the job? Why does it, everybody's saying it has to be a town resident? Do you have to be a town resident in order to be town manager the way this is written, or can we go to a larger pool outside the town and ask them or require them to move to town after they've been elected or appointed?
Attorney Miaras.
So the provision as drafted gives a new town manager 6 months from the time of appointment to move into town.
Correct. So they don't necessarily have to live in town in order to get the position. Is that correct?
At the time that they're appointed, they don't have to live in town as it's presented, but eventually they do have to live in town.
So presumably anyone who's appointed will have this requirement called to their attention, and they will have to indicate that they intend to comply with it, or presumably the selectman won't pick that person.
So as a follow-up, this doesn't tie our hands and make the pool of applicants smaller. We still have the same pool of applicants. I mean, we can still go outside the town and hire a town manager.
Presumably, potential applicants will look at this requirement and make a decision about whether to apply or not based on whether they think they'd be willing to move to Hopkinton.
Thank you.
Mr. Markey.
Mr. Moderator, Joe Markey, 39 Ash Street. I move the question.
Is there a second?
Second.
Actually, I will give the maker an opportunity to close the discussion.
I appreciate it. All I want to do is actually clear up a couple of things for the record. First of all, I'm well aware of how hard our current town manager works tirelessly, and this is not meant to reflect my opinion on his performances or anything like that. I don't know who said this, but I'm well aware that the town manager doesn't set the tax rate, as I assume everybody does. The point was, our tax rate, in my opinion, relative to some other, I don't know about the benchmark communities, but other communities, has been growing tremendously.
Okay.
So then the other thing Dale was mentioning about the qualified applicants. It doesn't make the pool smaller, except that, as Mr. Miari said, some people may not choose the position because of the residency requirement. But it's not unusual to have residency requirements for many municipal positions in towns and cities, including some of the ones mentioned earlier. With respect to the substantive changes at the 11th hour, I think that's the whole point of reviewing the town charter and revising it in this form. And the other thing is it's every 10 years that we get a chance to do this.
Okay, speak to the amendment.
So that's it.
Okay. A motion has been made to close debate, so we'll take a motion. We'll take a voice vote to confirm that you want to limit debate at this point. All those in favor of limiting debate, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so we've limited debate. We will now vote on the amendment that has been proposed, which is to impose a residency requirement on the town manager position. So a vote in favor would impose that residency requirement. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
No. And it's clearly defeated. Okay. At this point, we have considered the two items that we agreed last evening to end up laying on the table and bringing forward this evening. So I think we're at a point where we want to proceed to a vote on
point of order.
Okay, point of order.
I do have an alternative amendment that was I wanted to put in place of the town treasurer amendment.
I'm going to rule that we had an opportunity last evening to comment on any other aspect of the charter. We agreed to defer two items to this evening, and we've considered those two items at this point.
I believe we decided to defer discussion, but I didn't hear that the floor is closed to amendments. For instance, the residency amendment was not mentioned yesterday.
It was.
Was that?
It was.
All right.
The two items that were mentioned yesterday were the proposal that you had relative to town treasurer.
I mentioned that I had an alternative amendment to the one that was in place in that earlier.
I honestly don't recall that there was discussion of a third item that we would consider this evening.
Not yesterday, but today, earlier, tonight.
Well.
And I asked you procedurally what was the best way to proceed. The alternative amendment I have was in place of the treasurer position, which I would have preferred to have pulled back.
Give me a minute.
Sure.
Okay, please go ahead and make your amendment.
Thank you. I move that we
do we have it on screen as well?
Coming up. It's the creation of a town ombudsman position. This will fit the need to have an elected position in town hall that can represent the voters in town hall and be independent of the town hall structure, but also be a positive part of the town hall structure. The town ombudsman, which maybe can have a different name for her, would have an elected person in place that would be able to oversee issues and troubleshoot issues. The function of the town ombudsman would be to direct the citizens to the proper town officer, board, or committee to deal with the issue or concern of the citizen, to set up appointments for citizens to meet the directors, department heads, and boards or committees as appropriate, to provide citizens with access to public information within the town, and to otherwise serve the public in connection with the dealings with the town. The ombudsman will serve on the appropriations committee as a non-voting member and attend all annual and special town meetings. I haven't read the latest version that was sent up as it was vetted by town council, but the ombudsman would be elected position for 3 years, and if the office is vacant, it would be appointed by chairman of the board of selectmen, town moderator, and town clerk, and serve until a new town ombudsman would be elected at the next election. This would be effective for May 2018 annual town election. This is an effort, again, to have some oversight with the town, to be able to troubleshoot, to get departments to work together to solve issues. For instance, we have issues with CPC funding question and how do we resolve that? Or is the Director of Finance has a part of it, the CPC has a part of it, and how do we resolve that? If we have citizens with questions, they'll ask, you know, does the planning board do this? No, the planning board does maybe more real estate kind of ideas, not financial ideas. And the ombudsman would be able to set people in the right direction if they're not getting their questions answered at town hall. And it's an effort to, again, be the voice of the people in town hall to work with the structure that is in place in addition to what we have.
Is there a second? Discussion.
Mr. Moderator, Brian Herr.
Actually, you know what? Before Brian, I'd like to ask Pam Wexlax, okay, the Charter Review first, if the committee has an opinion or not.
The committee did not know about this until just now. I knew about it earlier this evening. So we do not have a position on this. And once again, I will request that if our committee members have an opinion, to please speak as a resident.
Okay. Mr. Herr.
Mr. Moderator, I serve as the chairman of the Board of Selectmen here in town, so I'm the single individual elected by my peers to do exactly what is described on the screen this evening. You could replace ombudsman with chairman of the Board of Selectmen, and everything that's up there, I try to facilitate and do every day. I'm opposed to this amendment. It's just adding another position in town government. It could increase costs in town government. And I don't think it would change the efficiency or effectiveness of town government in any way, shape, or form. If there's anything the citizens of Hopkinton are interested in with respect to the job description here, please shoot me an email at town hall. Thank you.
Thank you. Muriel.
Muriel Kramer, 39 North Street. I had the happy opportunity to serve in the same position as Mr. Herr, and I find myself agreeing with him completely on those comments. I celebrate the attempt to insert more elected positions. However, this one feels a little bit slapdash and late in the day, and there are better ways to do this. I'd also like to suggest that we have a very hard-serving Board Appropriations Committee who does a tremendous job, largely unobserved by the public. And I would invite anybody who is interested in oversight of the town's finances to attend those meetings and participate.
Thank you.
Pam Waxlax, 15 Smith Road. I'm speaking against the amendment. I believe, in addition to the Board of Selectmen, this is the town manager. If I don't know what's going on in town or have a question, the first person I'm contacting is the town manager for this and getting answers. I do agree that there is a potential for lack of the ability of one hand to know what the other hand is doing, but I also think it's the responsibility of the residents of the town to go and find that out if they're interested.
Thank you.
Jean Birchman, Forsyther Mill Road. I'm a lot shorter than Pam. I also am against this amendment. I think one of the things that we did as part of our review of the charter was look at an org chart of the entire town, and it's beyond me where this would fit in. I think, as people have already stated, this essentially is taking over pieces of the role of the Board of Selectmen. I think it's most appropriately, those jobs are most appropriately filled by the Board of Selectmen, who we also elect. For people who are dissatisfied with that, there's a public comment meeting at every meeting of the Board of Selectmen, and they're all easily available. In addition, the town manager is responsible for facilitating quite a bit of this, and I even see some pieces of the town clerk's position in there. So I don't know where you would fit this in. I don't know if this is meant to be a paid or unpaid position and where the funding would be found for that. And there really is no authority for this person to direct any of these activities to take place at any rate. So I really think that if people have questions or concerns, they already have every available option to get those questions resolved under our current structure, and this is just superfluous and confusing.
Thank you.
Mr. Moderator, Rick Flannery, 296 Hayden Row Street, member of the Charter Review Committee. We had well over 20 public meetings as well as two public forums, and this position was never discussed at any time during that or brought to our attention that it might be considered. Maybe had it been, we might have been able to review it, vet the potential of it, and provide some feedback to the person. But at this point, I'm opposed to it. I don't know what this person would be assigned to do, what type of enforcement authority the person would have, what his salary is, how it would be set. I'm sure there's no salary administration plan, so it would probably fall back to another person that had to be provided the salary voted upon at town meeting, would be my anticipation. So for those reasons, I stand opposed to this amendment.
Thank you.
Frank Durso, 173 Saddle Hill Road. At the very least, this is something we can think about for the next 10 years. At best, this is an opportunity to add to what we do have at Town Hall. It is not meant as any slam against the Board of Selectmen or anyone in Town Hall. It's an addition to help bring oversight for the people that have questions. I get lots of calls on the planning board for things that aren't even about the planning board, and I'm sure you guys get lots of calls. And there are things that I don't know where to send people sometimes, and we figure it out eventually. Our staff at Town Hall is very, very good, very sharp, but it would be good to have someone there that is responsive, that is their job, to help people get the answers they need directly. People often don't come to Town Hall, to town meeting. A lot of people, we're less than 1% of the town is here. We have people that don't come to meetings. When they do come to meetings at Town Hall, they may be intimidated to speak. But having one person that's a friendly face, that's not the chief, not on the Board of Selectmen, it's not the town manager, but it's a regular everyday person that they can ask questions of, and that person gets them answers. That's the whole reason of this, and I hope that people support it. Thank you.
Mr. Weissmantle.
Ken Weissmantle, 145 Ash Street. I'm opposed to this amendment. Our town isn't this big that we need one of these guys. I mean, we're a small town.
Or gals.
What?
Or gals.
Oh, gals. Yes. The town isn't this big. Also, if you go into Town Hall, you go to almost any open window or desk, and you'll get directed as to where you go. It's just not a problem that we have in town. We have very responsive town clerk to any questions. If you go to pay your bill and you ask for direction to go from there, they'll tell you where to go up. The Board of Selectmen's office, town manager's office, has got...
they're always willing to tell you where to go.
Getting answers is not a problem. I mean, from a planning office, I spend a lot of time meeting with people and citizens and assisting them in their day-to-day contacts and dealing with the planning department. And we're always available for meetings for that type of thing. And I'm sure every other elected board does absolutely the same. Therefore, I don't think we need this extra person on board.
Thank you. Mr. Markey.
Hi, Joe Markey, 39 Ash Street. I'll take a different tact. I want to know how much this position pays, because it looks like a lot of fun. You just basically walk around Town Hall, poke in, chat with Elaine, chat with Norman, and chat with all the fine citizens of Hopkinton. I think it'd be a lot of fun, so I would sign up. But seriously, I don't think this is needed. I think it's duplicative. The Board of Selectmen, as Brian pointed out, are in this role already. In fact, I'll go further and say it's 8:45. There's a lot of serious content in the charter that we haven't gotten to yet about reporting authority and things like that. There may be other points of discussion worth more of our time than this one. Thank you.
Darlene Hayes, 1/3 Road. Mm-hmm. I'd like to move the amendment.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of ending debate on this topic, signify by saying aye. Any opposed? Okay. So now we'll vote on this proposal, which is to establish the position of an ombudsman. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
And it's defeated. Okay. Having spent last evening going through the charter and this evening considering some motions that were deferred to this evening. I think we're ready for a vote on Article 1 itself, unless there are any further questions or discussion relating to the charter.
Scott Glover, 26 Cross Street. Just a quick question on under Article 6, Administrative Organization, Section 6-5, Term of Office, which says it's a new addition. I'm just kind of wondering who this relates to, which board members, and what the purpose of this Term of Office section is from the committee.
Pam?
I'll give it a go. I believe this is basically so that if a committee, say for example, appropriation committee, they've not found a successor yet, the current person in the position that might have been expiring can continue to serve until a successor is found.
That's good. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir, Mike Shepard. I don't mean or want to prolong this painful episode any further. I just wanted to get up here as a citizen to publicly thank the members of the Charter Commission for the great job they've done. I really appreciate your work, as well as all the work of the people on the stage and the Board of Selectmen. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Mike Heumann at 24 Chestnut. The only thing that I've noticed during the meeting last night and this meeting tonight is that there have been a lot of people who seem to want to add on or change things that are in this article. And that says to me that this article needs to go around again to mature more and maybe to address the things that people have brought in to try to change in this article. I don't think it's ready, and I would vote against it until such time as all these other questions, you know, have been addressed and maybe some more changes and some more discussion about that to make sure that everybody's happy, because this is going to change our town and change the face of it. And it's one of those things that you really have to be careful of when you vote, because I, in my opinion, you lose freedom with this. Thank you.
Frank Dursel, 173 Saddle Hill Road. As one of the people bring changes up, that is not what I was thinking at all. I support the charter as it is. We made some suggestions that came up. We voted. That's democracy. And I support the document as it stands. I'm here to support it. I stand in support of it.
Thank you.
Mr. Moderator, move the question, please.
Is there a second? All those in favor of limiting debate signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Okay. So now we're ready for a vote on Article 1 as amended, incorporating all of the amendments that in fact were voted in favor of by town meeting. This requires a two-thirds vote and ultimately will require a majority vote at our balloting in this upcoming May. In order to confirm that we've got two-thirds, I think we'll do this as a standing vote. So,
order.
Yes?
We have a quorum. Are you sure?
There is no, interestingly, the quorum requirement with respect to non-financial items is one person. So we do have a quorum. Well,
if there's zero, there's no meeting.
So all those in favor of Article 1 as amended, please rise and hold your orange card.
Sam, you're all set.
17. Selectmen can sit.
Center rear. Unanimous, 20 people.
Sixteen center front.
38 right of center.
38. Waiting on the left side.
Left, 27.
118, okay. And those opposed, please rise.
Center front, 0.
Center back, 0.
Left, 1.
Right, right of center, 0.
And it's almost unanimous and so voted. Okay, before I entertain a motion to adjourn, I would like to extend my thanks to the Charter Review Committee as well. I'd also like to thank the Appropriations Committee, the School Committee and the School Building Committees, the Board of Selectmen and the Town Manager and the Town Clerk, and Town Council. Thank you very much. We'll see you in the spring. Do I hear a motion to adjourn? Okay, thank you and good night. Drive safely. And Deputy Town Moderator. And the counters.